everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us stand for worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Trust you and obey when you're
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank the Lord. That's why we're here tonight, is just to say yes to the Lord. Amen. For Him to move upon us, to minister in and through us and to us, and to speak to us. And when He speaks, to just say, Lord, yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We want to pray and take needs to the Lord tonight, and I know that there are a number of needs, and there's those that are in the hospital, and I would just mention quickly Juanita Cartwright, still in the hospital, but doing so good, out of intensive care. Even yesterday, last night, I went up and she was in a room doing great, and she said, Jesus is alive. Hallelujah. Amen. So we thank the Lord for that. Continue to pray for her. Other sicknesses in our church family. Amen. We want to pray for this service tonight and just ask God to move in a mighty way, to speak to us. Amen. He knows exactly what we need and what we need to hear. And I believe that through the man of God, we can receive that word tonight. I want us just to pray together right now and just ask the Lord to do the work that He desires in our hearts. Amen. And in needs in your lives, lift those needs before Him right now. Let's pray in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of the Lord, how grateful we are, Lord, for your mighty power and spirit that is here. Oh God, we believe you now, Lord, that you will minister. I pray, oh God, that you will touch. I ask now, Lord, that you would minister in every need. You know every request that was turned in tonight. I pray, God, that you would supply. I pray, Lord, God, you would just minister to those that are sick tonight, those in the hospital, Lord. Raise them up as a testimony of your power. Those, Lord, who are dealing, Lord, with a crisis in their lives, I pray that you would touch, that you would intervene for them tonight. You see those, Lord, who are dealing, Lord, with emotions and, Lord, in situations, oh God, I pray that you would, Lord, just touch and reach to them. I pray for this service, for your divine will and purpose to be accomplished. Lord, let your will be done in this service, just as if it was in heaven. Oh Lord God, let your kingdom come. We believe you for it now, and we thank you for it, and we give you praise, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. God bless you. Make somebody feel real good before you sit down. Turn around and give them a good smile, maybe a handshake or a fist bump or a high five or something there. Praise God. Just let them know you're happy to see them in church tonight. Amen. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Amen. I would invite our ushers to come to prepare to wait on us as we give in our offering tonight. And what a privilege it is to have Brother James Hughes, Dr. James Hughes from Houston, Texas, with us. He was with us in 2007, and it's just a joy to have him back after a number of years here. We've heard him, of course, at a number of other venues, but you're going to be blessed tonight, and I just want to thank you in advance for giving to support this weekend and to meet the needs financially, and I appreciate that so very, very much. Also, while you're preparing your offering, I want to remind our men what's going to happen in the morning. Men's prayer breakfast. What time is that going to be? 8 o'clock, all right. And you will want to be here. Dr. Hughes actually is going to be our guest speaker in our men's prayer breakfast in the morning as well. How blessed we are. We are just, we're going to work him from can to can't here. Amen. Tomorrow night, also I would mention, because it was not published on our on our printed material. But tomorrow night, Dr. Hughes will be speaking to our couples. It's not just limited to our first church couples, but any couples from any church or no church. They're welcome tomorrow night for this special session, especially for couples. And that will be at 6 o'clock. Everybody say 6 o'clock. Because that just, you know, a little different there. So just be aware of the 6 o'clock start time tomorrow night. Amen. God bless you as you give tonight. Amen. Brother David, would you pray and ask God's blessings on our giving tonight? Praise God. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you give. And I do want to just say how happy we are to see a number of guests, some from some of our other churches, sister churches around. And we're so excited to see you, as well as even some of our pastors. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Why don't we just make all of our guests real welcome right now? Amen. Praise God. Amen. Thank the Lord. And God bless you as you continue to give and as you continue to worship in the service tonight.
worship him right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. I don't know what you may have walked in here tonight with in the form of an impossibility. But I'm telling you tonight, you've come to the right spot. Because we are worshiping tonight a God who delights in impossibilities. Hallelujah. He stood up to begin his ministry. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." Jesus Christ came on this earth to right all of the wrongs, to restore every individual that needed restoration, for all of the spiritually destitute. He said, "I've come to preach the gospel of good news." If you're blind and you need vision, he said, "I've come to restore your vision." If you have been in bondage, I've come to set you free. Hallelujah. And I feel his presence in this house. Tonight, our first night of restoration, God is getting ready to do a great work. And that is going to continue throughout this weekend. And I'm asking you for you to open up your heart and to bring your impossibility unto the Lord and allow God to heal you, bring sight to you, lift you up out of bondage, set you free, speak new vision into your life. The Lord wants to restore you here tonight. Praise God. Can we put our hands together unto the Lord one more time? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. We have with us tonight, amen, a very special guest, and he is not a stranger to this church, amen, long before we got here. But 30 years ago, I became in contact with this man and his family. He was one of my Bible school instructors. He's become a very close friend. He ministered in our wedding a number of years ago, and he's been a part of our life all along the way. Through ups and downs, hills and valleys, victories, amen, there has been a special bond that has grown here. And the most important thing that I love about this man is he is a man of God, and when he steps to the pulpit, he has a word from God. And I am asking for your attention, amen, as he comes. And as he comes, I want to remind everybody that for our couples tomorrow night, you do not want to miss that. There will be child care provided, and so we want everyone to be a part of that. Amen. Why don't we give the Lord and Brother Hughes a good hand as he comes? Let's preach with him tonight.
Why don't we give that all to the Lord? He's the one who deserves it. Lord Jesus, we stand in awe of you tonight. There is none like you. What a privilege to be in your presence. We magnify the name that's above every name. We give you glory and honor today, Jesus. You and you alone are worthy. What an incredible presence of the Lord that's here tonight. He is the master of impossibility. Amen. If you have your Bibles, let's go to the book of Colossians. I'm going to start in the third chapter, but I will back up to the first chapter tonight. But let me begin reading from chapter 3 and verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. Let's go back to chapter 1 now and start reading in verse 12. Chapter 1. Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. I want you to notice verse 13. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. And for a few moments tonight, I want to speak to you about translated. The Lord bless you, may be seated. Before I begin tonight, let me say what an incredible honor it is to be here. You folks have moved into a new building since I was here last. The Lord has given you a beautiful church. Wow. The Lord really didn't give it to you. You worked to build it. Brother Phillips, you did a great job. A lot of sweat and hammer went around here to get all this done. What a beautiful place. It's just an honor to be here. And Brother and Sister Phillips, it's such an honor to be with you. And Brother and Sister Milligan, I count as some of the greatest people I've ever met in my life. And it's been an honor to be part of their life. I remember my first encounter with Brother Milligan in the late 80s as a student at the Bible College. And he always loved the Word of God. And he still does. I enjoy being around people who like to talk about the Bible. I don't have much to say about politics. If you want to talk about sports, I can't talk with you about them because I have no clue who plays for who or what's going on, because I just don't care anymore. They're all a bunch of spoiled jerks, and they're teaching our children lots of bad things, and I just don't care about none of them anymore. Don't pay attention to them. They don't have nothing to offer me or my life, or they don't make my life better. And so, but when I find people who enjoy talking about the Word of God and the Bible, I just enjoy doing it. Brother Milling and I spent an hour today or more on our drive from Nashville here just talking about the Bible and the Word of God. That ought to be our passion. See, Paul says to the Colossians, you need to set your affections on things that are above, not on things on this earth. Our desires, our ambitions, our goals, everything about us should be pointed upward, not outward. But our world's changed. As I begin to study the life of Paul and his writings, and last May I had an incredible privilege of standing in old ancient Ephesus, walking down those old stone streets that they have uncovered, and just listening and looking at things that were there. We got to the Colosseum, and I was actually with about 25 or 30 missionaries. I had done their missionary retreat for the Middle East, and we went to Ephesus because our hotel was only 7 miles from this old city. And so I I left them. They were in the bottom of the Coliseum, and I just started walking, and I walked all the way to the top on the side that I was on, and I just walked the rim of that old ancient Coliseum. And as I'm walking that rim of that Coliseum, the Lord just began to bring scriptures back to my mind, and I started thinking about some things that I hadn't paid attention to closely before. And standing there looking down that old highway that led from the seaport into the city, I thought about the fact that there's where Paul met John's disciples and asked them, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" The Lord began to deal with me about the world you and I live in and the church you and I are part of. When Jesus came into this world, there was not a lot of people looking for him. Matter of fact, I can only find two people recorded in Scripture that were actually looking for his coming. Everybody else wasn't interested. Now, when he began to teach and preach, and he challenged their thought process, they began to argue with him. But they weren't looking for him. I'm wondering today, in this last hours of time, have we got so distracted by our world that we're really not looking for him anymore and anticipating his return? Because we've let our affections get attached to things in this world instead of his world. We've allowed this world to affect the way we think, the way we act, the way we respond. We've taken on their philosophies and their ideas, and we've let it affect us. And so today we're arguing about whether or not you really need to have the Holy Ghost to go to heaven, and is it necessary to be baptized in his name, and is the Holy Ghost really, is there a heaven or hell? Because our affection has lost its connection to the world we should be looking for, and we've let it start being attached to the world that we're around. When Paul writes to this church at Colossae, at the time of this writing, according to history, this church had decreased in size to only about 50 people. The town had less than 500 people in it. And here's this very small congregation that Paul writes this powerful letter to. And he writes to them about revelations that he hasn't shared anywhere else. You see, it's in this letter that we find the statement that in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him. When you get the Holy Ghost, you don't need more of God. You don't get half-born. When a child is born, it didn't come out one appendage at a time. And once all the appendages arrive, you snap it all together. When you're born into God's family, you are born into his kingdom. You get all the Holy Ghost that's possible at that time. We need to learn how to use it, not get more of it. You can't get more of God. What you need to learn how to do is live in what you have inside of you. And Paul writes to this church and reminds them that you don't need anything else besides him. We're trying to add too many things to our relationship with God. And all these things we're adding is affecting how we connect to God. I just a few months back, actually the weekend before Thanksgiving, I was in a church. Bill Milligan and I talked about this today. And I was there for a singles conference, and started on Thursday night. We'd had sessions Friday, and we were having our Friday night session. The pastor was not able to be there. He had been called away to speak at a funeral of a friend, and so he wasn't there. And so it was just the church staff and the speakers for the singles conference that was there. And we had started the service that night, and it was obvious God wanted to do something for us. The power of God began to move in that place, and people started responding. But as the service progressed a little bit, the song started changing, and they start singing another song. And the more they sang that song, the more agitated my spirit got. And I guess now at close to being 65 years of age, I just don't have time for a lot of nonsense anymore. And the fact is, we can sing some of the stupidest stuff that's out there, and I have no clue where it comes from or why we sing it, but it's just pure dumb. And I'm listening to this, and it's just irritating, because I'm thinking, these are some of the dumbest words I've ever heard in my life. And then the Lord spoke to me. And when he spoke to me, it was very emphatic. And the Lord said, I am tired of my children speaking in terms about me and singing about me in ways that's derogatory to my name and my nature. You don't have to crawl through a hot, burning desert to find God. You couldn't find God if your life depended on it. God finds you. Jesus said, the day cometh, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, and the Father seeketh such. You don't look for God. God starts trying to find you. God's not mean. He hasn't left us destitute. We talk about God as if he's the worst father in all the world. God's never had the authorities called on him for child abuse. He don't beat his kids up. He don't make public spectacles out of them. He don't stand them up and embarrass them or shame them or humiliate them or make them feel worthless. Well, this problem is not new. This church at Colossae was doing the same thing that I'm talking about tonight. See, there's a heresy at this church that Paul realizes, even though they're only 50 in number, if this heresy gets out, it has the potential and power to destroy the church. So I've got to write, and I've got to address these issues, and I've got to make them understand that what you're saying about God is not true. God's greatest desire is to bless you. You don't earn God's blessing. You don't have to do one thing to get God to bless you. God blesses you because you carry his name and you're his child. He blesses you in spite of you most of the time. The blessings of God are not earned. You can't do enough to get God to bless you. God blesses you because he wants to do it. It's his greatest desire to do so. Jesus said, it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. God has no trouble blessing you or honoring you or making your life better. This church had come up with this idea, and it was becoming prevalent. Actually, it's the first problem that had to be addressed in the New Testament church. Within 7 years of Pentecost, in 40 AD, James has to write the first book of the New Testament. And that first book of the New Testament instantly begins, after one verse of introduction, it instantly begins with temptation and with struggle. And it says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life. But let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, because God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. If you didn't have a good devil, you could not exist. You'd have nobody blame your problems. And the more I deal with people today, the worse it gets. We will never accept responsibility for our behavior. It's almost impossible to get somebody to say, you know what, I'm guilty here. I did this. There's always a reason. If he hadn't done this, this wouldn't happen. She hadn't done this, this wouldn't happen. Or the devil put words in my mind. He put thoughts in my mind. He did all these things. So Paul's dealing with this same mentality. James had to start dealing with it. Now Paul says, whoa, this thing is getting totally out of hand, and I've got to address it. So here's what I want you to understand. I want you to understand that he hath delivered us from the power of darkness. He hath delivered us from the power of darkness. Delivered from the power of darkness. Satan has no control of your life. When you are born again and you become a child of God, he loses all connection to your life. He can't do one thing to you anymore. He has no access to you. And when you talk about it in terms that he's doing things and putting thoughts in your mind and words in your mouth, what you're saying is that your father don't care enough about you to keep you safe. What you're saying is that God doesn't protect his children, and he doesn't keep a good home, and his home is always in chaos, but he allows his enemy into his house to wreck his kids' lives. Paul has to say, he had delivered us from the power of darkness. Satan has no control over the life of a blood-bought child of God. Now, if you're not blood-bought, he can do anything he wants to with you. He can do with you at his will. Now, when you get the Holy Ghost, you do not become God's puppet. God doesn't start controlling your life and making you do things that you didn't want to do. He doesn't attach strings to you, and he wiggles those strings, and an arm moves, and a leg moves, and he moves you here and moves you here. You're not God's puppet. God takes the control. He delivers you from the power of Satan. He takes the control of Satan out of your life, and he removes it. He no longer controls you. Now he gives control of your life back to you. He makes you just like Adam in the garden. You now have control of every aspect of your life. You have control of your thoughts. You have control of your emotions. You have control of your behavior. You have control of your decision. It's now in your hands. Now you're in charge of life. Now you got a problem. You got an empty throne. Satan's no longer the throne of your life. It's empty. So now you got to make a decision about who gets to take ownership of the throne of your life. And here's the two options that are available. You're either going to put God on the throne of your life, or you're going to crawl up on the throne of your life. You say, you can't prove that, Brother Hughes. Absolutely I can. Why, if that's not the case, then why did Paul say, I beseech you that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. This is what I expect out of you. You got to crawl off the throne of your life and let God reign in your life. If you don't, you'll become the most evil thing that exists. You've been delivered. He took the power of Satan off my life. He gave my life back to me. Now, when I lived over here, when I was part of this family, I sinned by nature. I had no choice. That's who I am. But the instant I become a child of God, and I'm buried in his name, baptism, and the new birth takes place, and I'm that born again child, born of water and spirit,
When I am born again, I get a nature change, because all things become new. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. I am a new creature, or creation, in Christ Jesus. I'm a brand new person. As this new creation, I don't sin by nature. I sin by choice. When I get to this side of the water, it's not a nature thing. It's not, well, I couldn't help it. That's just the way I am. When I get over here, everything I do is by decision. I can't blame nobody else for it. And the moment that I take people's responsibilities away from them and assign it to a spirit, they are no longer accountable for anything they do. And we're making spirits out of too much stuff that's not spirits. See, the moment you make a spirit out of it, the human is now free, because they can't help it. It's a spirit influencing them. We got to learn to take ownership of me. See, I don't really need a devil to be bad. I'm real capable of that by myself. So are you. I can introduce you to the devil. Go look in the mirror. See, I'm convinced that humans make the devil blush. We can create things he can't create. We can do things he can't do. God put his creative nature inside of every one of you. And you can create so much chaos that the devil stands and blushes at the chaos you create, because he used to live in heaven. But us humans got to have somebody to blame, because it's not my fault. I'm not responsible. You don't understand. I can't help myself. I've got an anger problem, or I've got a jealousy problem, or I've got a lust problem, and you don't understand. I just can't control it. That's a lie. I can control me. I just have to choose to. There's not a devil big enough to keep me from controlling me. There's not a spirit big enough to keep me from becoming the person that God designed me to be. Satan doesn't have that power. I have been delivered from the power of darkness. I have been free. The word delivered means to free hostages at spear point. So he took me out of the hostage situation, and now I don't have shackles anymore. I'm not bound to that. I am free from the power of darkness. But I'm not just free from the power of darkness. The power of darkness is here. He didn't just free me from the power of darkness, but he translated me into the kingdom of his dear son. And that's a term we don't understand, because it has nothing to do with our culture or the way we live or any of our lifestyles. When Rome captured a nation and they brought that nation under the authority of Rome, that general that conquered that nation gave them the option of joining the Roman Empire and swearing their allegiance to Rome and pledging their allegiance to the Roman Empire and becoming part of that empire. If they would agree to do that, they would never have soldiers stationed in their nation anymore. They would be allowed to be free and do whatever they chose, as long as they come under the authority of the Roman Empire. They could actually send representatives to Rome to be part of the Roman government if they chose to be under the authority of Rome. If they refused, that Roman general would take them to the closest seaport. Even if the nation they conquered was one attached to the top part of what now is present-day Italy, which would have been France or any of that southern part of Europe, even if they conquered them that close, they still took them to the closest seaport. And they put them on a boat. They could have marched them by land to Rome, but they wouldn't do that. They put them on a boat, and they sailed them across the Mediterranean Sea so that they landed in the port of Rome, so that in their minds they were reminded between where they were and the old place they lived at was a whole lot of water that they had to get across to get back to what they used to be. You think this baptism thing is just something minor? See, when he makes you part of his kingdom, he translates you across the water into the kingdom of his dear son. Now you are separated from where you used to live by water, and Satan can't get through the water. He has no power on this side of the water. He has no authority on this side of the water. He's still on the other side. So they translated them and took them to Rome and made them be part of Rome until they could swear allegiance to the Roman Empire. Then they'd take them back home. I've been translated. I have been delivered. But he didn't just deliver me. He took me out of his influence. He moved me through water over here to a brand new life. Now I have a new name. I have a new address. And I have a new coat of dress. That's adoption. See, at the day of adoption, when you was adopted in the family, you changed your address. You didn't live at your old house. You had a new house. You changed your name. You didn't have the old name. You have a new family name. And you put on the clothes of the family that you were part of. And you dressed like the family that you became part of. So whatever color their robes were, that's the color that your robes become. Because your robes represented your family name. And it showed that you were connected to a brand new family. He translated us from one kingdom. And then he adopted us. We got a new name. A new address, a new father, a new lifestyle. I now can do anything. Now I can do all things through Christ which strengtheth me. All things. Now, the last time I checked, that word all is inclusive. That doesn't mean there's some of them I can't do. I can now do all things through Christ which strengtheth me. I can live an overcoming life if I want to. I can be successful if I want to. I can be peaceful if I want to. I can be gentle if I want to. I can be kind if I want. I have a new nature and a new lifestyle that empowers me to become like my father and act like him and respond like him if I choose. Now on this side of the water, there are only two influences. God and flesh. There's nothing else. On the other side, there's Satan over there. But on this side, in this nation and this kingdom, it's God or flesh. The battle you fight is not with the devil. The battle you fight is with that stuff you live in called flesh. So Paul, writing to the church at Galatia, says that your spirit lusteth against your flesh, and your flesh lusteth against your spirit, and these two are contrary one to another. Your spirit is at war with your flesh, and your flesh is at war with your spirit, and you decide who wins. If you feed the flesh, flesh wins. If you feed the spirit wins. There's no devil causing that to happen at this house. If it is, then your father's mean because he lets somebody else wreck his kid's life, and then when he gets through, he's going to fix them. Be careful how you talk about your dad. He's getting irritated at the way we talk about him and the way we act and some of the things we say that bring dishonor to his ability to be a good father and protect his children. And provide for his children. He's not out to wreck my life. He's out to make my life better. He's not out to give me a totally different kind of life to live. He has delivered me from the power of Satan and translated me. I've been delivered from Satan. Well, let me point something out about Satan that I discovered a few years ago. When Jesus was teaching, according to Luke, they began to question what he was doing. And he had cast the devil out of someone who had a spirit. And they said, "You did that by the devil." Jesus' response said, that a house divided against itself will fall. But if I, with the finger of God, cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of heaven is at hand. When a strong man keeps his house, his goods are at peace. But when a stronger comes, he takes his house and he takes his armor wherein he trusteth, and he divides the spoils. Who's the strong man? Satan. Who's the stronger than the strong man? Jesus Christ. Jesus said to the devil, I've come to get your house. And when I get your house, I'm going to take everything you stole from my creation, and I'm going to give it back to them, and they're going to wear it every day of their life to remind you of what you have done and what your end is. For 4,000 years, he had tormented man. And Jesus said, from this point forward, for the next 2,000 years, my children will torment you. I'm tired of what you've done to my children. So from this point forward, when I take your kingdom away, and I take your house away, and I take your armor away, I'm going to put it on my kids. And when they walk through life with a helmet of salvation, a breastplate of righteousness, they're going to remind you that I defeated you, and you have no power over my children, because I have delivered them from your power. And you are powerless. Remember the story of the demonic Gadara? Remember that story? Before that story starts, Jesus has had a session teaching a multitude. And he's exhausted from arguing with people and being buffeted by people, and weary, he tells his disciples, we got to go to the other side of the lake. And he constrained them, get in a boat, put them in this boat. He said, all right, we're going to the other side. And as they get in the boat and start across the other side, Jesus goes back to the boat, lays down to rest, sleep. Storm comes up. Winds begin to blow. Waves begin to come over the bow of that ship. Now, when a storm comes with a small boat, it only has one option if it's going to stay afloat. And that only option it has to stay afloat is to face the wind. If it ever gets to where it's not facing the wind, it will be rolled over and everybody in it will perish. So it must always face the wind. The storm has to be faced. And when it faces the wind, it may not get anywhere, because the wind may be pushing them. And so for hours they row and row, and exhaustion starts taking place. They get in the boat at dark, 5-6 o'clock in the evening. At midnight, they are still rowing, and they've gotten nowhere. They can't turn around and go back. They'll wind up where their boat will sink. They can't go to the right. They can't go to the left. They have to keep facing that wind so that they will not be destroyed. They row and row and row, and finally the waters come over the boat so much that they're now bailing water and rowing at the same time, just trying to keep it above the water. Then finally someone in desperation says, you know, it's amazing how long it takes people to realize they need Jesus. Six to midnight, 6 hours, midnight to four hours, 10 hours into this. Finally, somebody says, we got to get Jesus up. We're all going down. Awaken him. And they awake Jesus, and he arises from the back of the boat, walks to the front of that ship, and he says, peace, be still. The wind stopped. And the scripture says those men in the boat were terrified, because they didn't know any man who had the power over wind. That he could say to the wind, shut up, and it shut up. Stop blowing. When he said, peace, be still, literally translates, shut up. No more sound out of you. Enough. Instantly, the waves laid down. You see, before Jesus could address devils and a demon, he had to take the kingdom of the demon away. First thing he had to do is conquer his kingdom he stole from man, which was the wind he was allowing to blow there. So the first thing he had to do was show Satan, I come to get your house. I can control everything you keep trying to do to my kids. Wind, shut up. Don't howl in their life no more. It's over. Done. Now, when you get tired of fighting the wind and you finally recognize you need Jesus in your boat, he's just going to say, shut up, and the wind's going to stop blowing. But he can't do that until you ask him into the bow of your boat. You got to connect so that it allows him to say to your world, peace, be still. Satan, you stole this from my kids. I come to take it back from you. You will never control them like this again. Instantly, he's on shore. 4 o'clock in the morning, they're on shore gathering. Out of the darkness of that night comes a screaming lunatic. Now, can you imagine those 12 men? They just escaped wind and a storm that's howled at them and nearly drowned them. And Jesus tells the wind to shut up. And the instant he does, they're on shore, here comes a screaming lunatic out of the night. In my mind, I can imagine those 12 men saying, what else is going to happen here? Here he comes, screaming at Jesus. And he throws himself at Jesus' feet and worships him. The Greek language nouns and verbs must agree in gender number. And if you want to make sure that everybody knows that what you're saying in the verb is not masculine or feminine, you put a new on the end of it, which means it's neuter. So the verb that he's used there has a new, removable new on the end of it, which means the man didn't run to Jesus, a woman didn't run to Jesus, but an it ran to Jesus. And an it fell at Jesus' feet, and an it worshiped the Lord Jesus Christ. Who's that it? 6,000 devils. See, their creator just stepped on shore. And the moment that creator stepped on shore, every devil around had to come and fall at his feet and worship him. Now, I can't find anywhere where Satan got his power back. I find he lost it all. Because Jesus' last words on the cross, according to John, wasn't, it's over. Jesus' last words on the cross was, it's finished, but it's tetelestai. John had no clue what that meant until he moved from Jerusalem to Ephesus, pastors that church there. Then he saw in that arena I stood in, he saw those Olympics take place, and he understood that word. He couldn't understand it until he got there. He heard Jesus, but he had no clue what it meant. But once in Ephesus, and he heard that word, he knew exactly what it meant, because that's the term used to describe the behavior of someone who just won an Olympic event. It's not, it's over, or I finished. It's the victor's shout of triumph. He screams, I won! Jesus' last words on the cross was, I won! It's not, it's over. I conquered him. He will not torment my kids one day more. He will not wreck somebody else's life. He will not have the power over my children. I won. Folks, do you understand the best place for the devil is right here? When you start worshiping God, he has no option but to join in and worship with you. When Jesus shows up, he's going to be part of what you do, because you've been translated into a new kingdom. You live in a new house with new power. Now, at this house, you're given the privilege of failing without embarrassment. Over there, that didn't happen. See, over there, if you failed, he'd rub your nose in it. He'd make everybody know how sorry you was and how worthy or what all these bad things over there. But at his house, if you fail, he don't rub your nose in it. Because in the next chapter, he says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, taking it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. See, when you live over here and you mess up, your life's not over. You don't throw in the towel and quit. You have this incredible ability that Peter preached about in Acts 3 when he said, repent you therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times refreshing shall come in the presence of the Lord. On this side, at this house, if you mess up, he don't erase your life. He don't destroy you. He don't make you feel worthless. That's what humans do. You know what? What is it in us that when somebody messes up, we can't help ourselves but say, told you so. If you listen to me, this wouldn't happen. What is it in us that we got to rub everybody's nose in their failure? Why aren't we that way? That's our nature. Someone fails, someone makes a mistake, we don't let them go. We embarrass them. He doesn't do that. He says, all right, I'll let you blow it out. What I need you to do is to write the confession out. I need you to take a piece of paper and write down what you've done. When you write it down, I need you to sign it at the bottom. And when you get your John Henry across the bottom, now, once you have confessed and spoken it, now you can erase it. So take that sponge, dip it in vinegar and water, squeeze it out, rub that sponge over that page. The vinegar and water dissolves. The ink sponge acts like a vacuum cleaner. And when you get through, you've got a blank page. There's not one word left on that page. But on this side of the water, you don't need vinegar and water. On this side of water, you get to use blood. On this side of the water, he says, where's your sponge at, son? Just carry it in your back pocket. Now, I don't expect you to live a life of failure. I want you to be an overcomer. But if any man sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is not only a propitiation for my sin, but he's a propitiation for the sin of the whole world. He not only takes care of me, but he'll take care of everybody else. So on this side of the water, if you mess up, you first have to take ownership. Say, you know what, God, I messed this up, brother. And you got to write out your confession and sign your name. And before the enemy can ever get into your life to use it to wreck your life, he said, all right, here's my blood. Take the sponge, dip it, rub it across your life. And when you get through, go to the lumber yard, buy your stake, get a nail, drive it in the end of that stake, drive that stake in the front yard, poke a hole in that skin of papyrus, and hang it on that nail so your neighbors know you've been forgiven. Nailing it to his cross. That's not about Jesus dying on the cross. That's that stake in the front yard with a nail in it. See, on this side, you don't get shamed. You don't get made fun of. You don't get ridiculed by God. God don't do that. Now, us humans, we do that. God don't. Over here, he said, all right, son, I see your repentance. I see your sorrow. I see your pain. I see you've taken ownership. Now let me help you change your life. Just apply a little bit of my blood to your life. And whenever you get the blood applied, then take the skin and hang it up to remind your neighbor, but it's also remind you, I'm forgiven. I'm a failure. I'm the chiefest of sinners. I can't do nothing but do things and make mistakes. But I want you to know that just come over to my house. See this nail? There are several pages here, and it doesn't matter how many pages are on the nail. If the nail can't hold it, get a bigger one. Get one that's longer so you can just keep adding pages, because I promise you, when you go down that water in his name and you come up out of that water speaking in tongues, you don't grow a halo. You don't get out of flesh. You just get out of Satan's house. and you get out of the bondage of what Satan wraps around your life and tries to make you feel worthless about. And when you get out of the water on this side, you still got flesh to battle with. And every day is going to be a battle. And I'm learning every morning I have to get up and say, all right, James, it's me and you today. It's going to be flesh and spirit. We're going to war. There's battle here. We're going to fight. And I don't know the outcome of this day. I may win, and I sure hope I do, and I'm going to try everything in my power to win. But if I don't, I'm going to march you to an altar. And you're going to write out your confession. And you're going to sign your name to it. And you're going to repent. And he's going to bring that bowl of blood and say, all right, son, you've done what I asked. Now let me take care so that this doesn't wreck your life from this day forward. This doesn't destroy you. This doesn't make you worthless anymore, because you're never going to lose your value at my house. Now, you might drop your diamond in mud. You might get a lot of dirt and grease on it. But when you get it picked up, you can still clean it off. And you'll be just as valuable after the cleaning as you was before the cleaning. Because at this house, he treats his kids with incredible honor and dignity. He loves them unconditionally. He don't beat nobody up. He don't make you feel worthless or belittle you or make you feel that you have no reason or purpose. He said, no, that's what Satan does. At this house, no. He don't have action. He's not going to trouble you. He's not going to torment you. I won't let him. So if you live on this side of the water and you start remembering things you used to do, you start remembering your failures, your mistakes, and you want to say, well, the devil's talking. He keeps reminding me of my past. You've assigned responsibility to the wrong thing. And it's not the devil. It's that flesh you live in. You know what I've discovered? I've discovered if you were a jerk before you got the Holy Ghost, you're going to be a jerk with the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost is not going to change your jerkiness. You're going to stand in front of a mirror and change you. You're going to take on a war of this stuff we live in called flesh that don't need one devil to make it bad. It doesn't need any help. It just needs somebody to blame. Oh, I can't help myself. I keep having these bad thoughts. I keep being tempted by these thoughts, and the devil's putting thoughts there. Well, quit reading the dumb stuff and looking at the dumb picture, and you won't have bad thoughts. You can't think about what you have put in. Not possible. Change where your eyes are. Get your affections where? I wonder what happened at God's house if all his kids got their eyes off of the world they live in and got their eyes on the world he lives in. I wonder what happened in our homes, in our relationships, in our marriages. And I wonder what happened between people if we'd quit looking this way and we start looking this way. We'd quit looking around and comparing ourselves and saying, well, you know, look at them. They're getting by. They're doing this. You start comparing yourself with yourself. I got to get my eyes here. And I got to realize I got the best father in all the world. And his desire is not to get even. If God won't get even, I promise you he can do it. God won't take you out. He wouldn't have no problem doing that. God's not trying to get even. God's trying to redeem. Jesus said, I am not willing that any should perish. Any. You know, the most difficult time I've had with God was over something I saw him do.
Then God had an issue over it. I didn't think he should do it. I saw God fill a pedophile with the Holy Ghost, and they baptized him in Jesus' name. I had trouble with that because I didn't think God should do it. I could forgive him as long as he wasn't going to heaven. Jesus said, I'm not willing that. You don't get to choose who God blesses, who God touches, who God restores, who God heals, who God delivers. I don't have that input. I'm not willing that any should perish. You want restoration in your life? First thing you got to do is let God be God. And you got to let God do what God wants to. You got to let God control life. So God, I put it in your hands. It's out of mine. I'm not willing that any should perish. Pedophile. He died 3 months later. Cancer he was eat up with. He's going to be in heaven. I know of at least 10 victims. Got the Holy Ghost, got baptized, become anew. He got translated. He moved to the other side of the water. So he's not willing any should perish. But as humans, we got problems with those things. Because it's in our nature to get even, settle scores. So we got to have our pound of flesh. They hurt us. No, can't let them go. Can't release it. Can't forget it. Can't forgive it. They hurt me. But you turn it loose, there is recovery because I've been translated. When I get here, I have so many privileges at this house. I'm not belittled for my mistakes. They're not paraded before the world. They're covered by blood. And when they're covered by blood, you know, every sin God's forgiven you of, where does an enemy get the ability to drag it back up? Where? How can he do that? If it's blood covered, how can he do that? He can't. So it's not an enemy. It's flesh. Because all that junk's hidden in my mind. And I'm the one who has power over this brain. And Peter said, gird up the loins of your mind. Modern day translation, don't let your mind flap in the breeze. You control it. When flesh wants to remind you of your failure, you say, flesh, come here, I want to show you something. Come, let me show you. I was standing, I was kneeling right there. And I signed the confession. I wrote out my sin and I signed the confession. And at this spot, he let me take his blood and the sponge I carry on my body. And he allowed me to erase that sin. And this page is to remind me and my world that I am forgiven and I'll never be judged for what I have repented of. Now that's true deliverance. He delivered me from the power of darkness, and now I get to go through the water to a new kingdom. Now, my Father fights my battles. See, God fights for you every day, and you don't even know it. You still live in a world controlled by the devil, so he's all around. But he fights him so that he can't affect you. He can't wreck your life. He can't destroy you. He's taken that authority away from him. Not at my house. These are my kids. And I won't let you wreck their lives. I am going to protect my children. First Adam wouldn't die for his wife. The second Adam said, I'll die for her.
and I'll stake my life on the, I'll put my life on the line. I'll die for her to make sure that her and her children are never destroyed by you one more time. You have lost your power. I will say to your world, peace, be still. And you have been neutralized and you can't wreck my kids no more. Now, some of you are looking at me real strange tonight because you got a problem. You got a real problem. You either have to take responsibility for all this junk you've been talking about, or you got to blame it on the devil. That's real difficult, isn't it? But if you make that decision, life changes. Please stand. Gracious Father, thank you for your incredible presence that we have felt here tonight. Lord, thank you for the privilege and promise. I don't believe that you show up. I know you show up. Your word said that where two or three of us are gathered together in your name, you are in the midst. I know you're here tonight. And I know that is your desire to touch your children. And I know that you are limited by your children's desire to let you in. And if they don't let you in their life and their heart, you cannot minister to them and help their lives. But if they'll open that door you've been knocking at and they'll let you in, you'll come in to them and you'll sup with them and you'll change their life and you'll make their life totally different than it has ever been before. You will free them from being a hostage of sin and give them a life beyond their ability to comprehend. Lord, I pray tonight that whoever that soul is that has been battling with this feeling of worthlessness, that I'm not important anymore, I can't do anything right, I'm just a mistake or a failure. I pray tonight revelation would happen for someone. I pray that they'd confess and sign the paper so that you can bring out the blood that allows them to erase a page of life and hang it on that stake in their life to show themselves and the world that they are forgiven. They're not perfect because you've never expected us to be perfect. Your word has never defined that we'd be perfect. Your word says, my little children, sin not, but if any man sins. You knew that we as humans would make mistakes. So you provided a covering. You brought us out, you delivered us, and you brought us across the water to your nation, to your kingdom, to your house. And when we get to your house, you now empower us that no matter what our flesh does, or if it fails, I can still get redemption. I don't have to go back and be buried in your name again. I don't need to be baptized again. I just need to repent, sign my confession, and take your blood and apply it to my life and change my life forever. Lord, I pray that revelation happens for somebody, that somebody gets free tonight, and they will no longer be controlled by their failures and their past mistakes and their shortcomings. Coming, but their lives will be totally free tonight, and they'll become that treasure that you created them to be. Your child, honorable, always honorable in your sight. Your prized possession, the reason you came to our world and died was because you wanted to redeem what was most precious to you, and that was your creation made in your image. Thank you for loving your creation enough that you gave your life so that we would have a covering to protect us from the sin that Satan introduced into this world by tempting Eve to fail, and he wrecked our kingdom, but you're giving it back to us tonight. So I pray someone takes over the throne of their life tonight. They empower you to become the God of their life, and they give their life to you, and they allow your spirit to bring them and deliver them and heal them tonight in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I wonder tonight, does anybody need to invite a devil that's been tormenting you for a few days? Do you need to just invite him to an altar and say, come with me, we're going to go worship the Lord tonight. And while I'm worshiping the Lord, I want to hear your voice loud and clear as you worship the Creator that made you, that you have no option
to do other than worship him. So come with me to the altar tonight. I want to make you worship the God that created you, because I'm going to worship him freely because I have the right to. And I am going to let my life be changed tonight. I'm going to worship him. I'm going to change my life tonight. I'm going to be different tonight. If you'll do that, your life will change. You'll become a brand new person tonight. But you got to reach out. You just have to. He can't do it for you. But if you will, shake your armor tonight. You need to show the devil. Torment him. He's tormented you. Torment him. Show him what you've got that he lost. Hold up that shield of faith. Show him the helmet of salvation. Let him see that you put on the armor he lost, that he took from you to start with. God gave it back. God gave it to you so that your life can be changed, that your life can become different. He's freed you tonight with the power of your spirit. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I worship you tonight, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. Harabakaha satayarabakaha. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I bless you.